Don't be afraid of who you are. That's where it starts. Don't be afraid of who you are. That's where it starts. Don't be afraid of who you are. That's where it starts. I'm just a vessel with the message, telling it from the heart. Don't be afraid of who you are. That's where it starts. Don't be afraid of who you are. That's where it starts. Don't be afraid of who you are. That's where it starts. I'm just a vessel with the message, telling it from the heart. Speak from the heart, it's like you reach different part. That part that sparks deeper thought, like the orgasm you lost. Believe what you want. Some people talk, but apply action they don't. Blessings can't show if you want. You ever had a problem? Problems seem large and you can solve it. Now you're on your knees calling. It's life for you. See the purpose, the struggle, show us what's right for us. Got a dream, fight for it, head right toward. Soon as I pass through a storm, I stop and write a poem. I document my transition back to my right form. Take the message, reflect it in precise form. Higher information, spiritual, lyrical life form. Shout out to the fan, rock this mic form. Shed light form, future looking bright form. Ego aside, it's just straight from the heart. I'm one of many who just playing a part. Listen, don't be afraid of who you are.
Family, what is up? What is up? Welcome back to another episode of the Why Not Podcast. I am honored to be here. My name is Teddy D. If you are reaching this show, more than likely this may not be your first one, but if it is, welcome. If it's not, welcome back. As always, you can reach out to me at the Why Not Podcast at gmail.com. We have a wonderful Facebook group as well, the Why Not Podcast. We have the black background and the red lettering. And, of course, you can call or text me, but that's only if you know me. So, you know, don't mean to be weird, but take that. So, man, you guys have been doing great, sending feedback, reaching out on Twitter and different avenues. And if I haven't reached back to you, I promise I will. But, you know, even though I'm relatively young, I'm an old guy at heart. So social media, you know, not the best, you know, just give me a little time. So today is a show that, man, let me tell you. So I've had this idea in my mind for a while. I wanted to talk about some subjects that I love that I haven't had a big chance to really get into. And I was thinking who could be some great guests that I can bring to you as an audience and that I would also enjoy talking to as well. And, you know, the power of Facebook. I reached out and these gentlemen agreed to be on, which I appreciate. But I guarantee you, even if I didn't know and love them, they would be stellar guests, A1, that anyone would be happy to get. So let me introduce you, family. We have first a brother that, listen, if you know me, you know the history. I grew up in the church, Greencastle Baptist, and I think both of them went at one point. But this brother, he and I grew up together, sang in the choir, got into some trouble per se, but not, you know, nothing big. But you know, he went on to leave the great city of Louisville, the not so great state of Kentucky, and go to Nashville, where he's been for the past 15 years. He is another proud supporter of HBCUs, and he is now in the financial world. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you my friend, Mr. Jamie Horton. How are you, sir?
I am doing well. What a lovely introduction. That's fantastic. Hey, that's fantastic.
It's all true, brother. It's all true. Tell me the lie. That's all I'm saying.
I spent about 30 seconds trying to find it. I couldn't, bro.
That's what's up, man. And if it was just Jamie, you would be happy. You'd walk away being like, man, I learned something. This is good. But then we brought in yet another impressive brother. Basically, on this show, you'll learn that I'm the least impressive on the mic today, and you'll see why in a second. This brother not only grew up in Louisville with us, I believe he's a fellow alum of Barrett TMS. Shout out to Barrett. He left the great city of Louisville and not so great state of Kentucky, and he went on to have a very distinguished educational career, which he will get into in a second. If I'm correct, he is also a member of the HBCU family. Shout out to that. And he is now actually an owner and slash operator, along with his partner, Mr. Al Duncan of a really great website that we're going to talk about, greatprospeakers.com. We have for you the Honorable Mr. Lawerence Watkins. How are you, sir?
I'm doing well, Teddy. It's good to talk to you. It's been a while.
I know it, man. I know. I think the last time we got a chance to chop it up was at a wedding, right? Was that Charles's wedding, Charles and Stacey's?
Oh, gosh. It was that long ago?
Yeah. that was the last time, man.
Yeah. That was a long time ago.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's right,
but I'm glad to be here today. Thanks for inviting me.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you for coming, man. So I want to start. We're going to reverse order. Lawerence, you have such a great story in that I'm sure that all of us that grew up with you, of course, we remember you as a great guy, a nice dude, always smart. But you have gone on to just do incredible things. Now, I alluded to your education. Could you walk me through where you went to school after you left Louisville and how you started your professional journey?
Okay, well, so I actually did not go to an HBCU. However, me and my brother, Dr. Boyce Watkins, who's another Louisville son, I suppose.
Yeah, that's right. We'll take him. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. We are starting an online HBCU kind of called the Black Business School. So to teach financial empowerment to African Americans all around the nation. Nice. So that is starting. But my education actually went from
Syracuse. That's what it was. I'm sorry.
No. We started in Syracuse. That's where the company was started. But
gotcha.
I am an alum of Speed School. So the Speed School of Engineering at the University of Louisville.
Nice.
Took a couple of years off right after graduation to help my brother with his speaking career and start my own company. And then went back to school to get my MBA from Cornell University in New York.
Very nice. Which is also HBCU, right? No.
No.
I kid, Lawrence. I kid.
You got me. Yeah. But shout out to the HBCU. Shout out to Fisk and TSU in Nashville. And,
yeah. Speaking of.
That's right.
Jamie, what could you give him a quick intro on your educational journey, sir?
Yeah, absolutely. So I left the fantastic city of Louisville and the not so great state of Kentucky, which I completely agree with.
Governor, the worst. Sorry.
And hit 65 southbound and landed at the illustrious campus of Fisk University, which is where I matriculated through, and had the honor to become a fraternity brother of the great and honorable Lawerence Watkins.
There you go.
That's right.
A5,
bro.
I was about to say, please feel free to rep your background. Go right ahead.
Oh, I mean, anytime there's money to be discussed, alphas are the scholars making dollars. So
that's right.
It just is what it is. You know what I mean?
Uh huh.
Just is what it is.
That's right.
That's nice, man. So today. Today is going to be a really fun show for me because this is going to give us a chance to get into some things that I really don't, I am a big fan of podcasts and specifically Black podcasts. That's always my preference. So when I listen to them, there are constants that I hear. You can always hear let me say this the right way so it doesn't come across, right? But, as Black people, We are the creators of trends and culture, all right? And I truly do believe that podcasting is just another form where people can listen and they can find out a lot about what's going on, not only in pop culture, but in relationships and music. The way that people look at life in general is all represented in Black podcasts. And a lot of times when you'll hear different shows, they have completely different takes on similar subjects. But one of the subjects that I would love to hear more about is one of the things that we're going to talk about today, and that's business, that's finance, that's really being as intentional as you can be about being as successful as you really do want to be, right? And one of the ways that I wanted to start off with that is just your overall look. And Lawrence, I think this would be interesting. Now, I do want to let you both in on a little prep work that I did, right? So I reached out to a couple of people who remain anonymous. And and I asked them, like, listen, this is who I got coming on the show. Do you have any questions or anything that you would like me to ask? And Listen, apparently y'all are hot in these social media streets, because every one of them had a question. So I'm like, I can't get to them all, but I'm gonna try.
Some people say that I'm too hot. I'm too hot on the social media streets.
No such thing.
I need to cool it down.
No such thing. So both of you have worked in your respective fields for several years now, and you always hear the general advice of you know, how to climb the corporate ladder or be a successful business owner. But I kind of want to get into the details a little bit more today. So I want to hear about not just some of the great things that have happened in your career, but some of the hard times that you've had, that you've had to overcome, what you've learned from it, and how it helped you improve as a person in your own field. Right. So, for example, I'll sacrifice myself first. Right. So when I first began in my career, I struggled because I've always worked for big corporations. I struggled in separating the business from the personal, because that's always my default as a person. You know, when I meet someone, I want to be as friendly as possible, get to know them, know about your family, whatever it is. So when I first entered the work world, I was a person that always wanted, you know, drinks with coworkers, hung out with kids' birthday parties, whatever it is. And it was all well and fine for me until it wasn't, right? And there was one specific case at one of my old jobs where I was up for a promotion and I didn't know the manager, but one of the people in the room was someone that I hung out with. Well, I didn't know it at the time, but someone else who applied was one of their friends. So they were asking everyone's opinion, like, hey, should we go with Teddy or should we go with the other person? And that person who was in the room said, you know, I hung out with him. I don't know, he's got a little bit of a temper, right? And he didn't know that another person in that room was a friend of mine as well. But lo and behold, that other person got the promotion. The friend came back and told me. I'm like, wow, like, you really can't open up to everybody that you work with. Like, cool, duly noted, bit me this time, next time I'll know. You know, hard lesson to learn, but so be it, right? So and while it doesn't have to be as sad as that, but just in general, what's one thing that you can think of? We'll start with Jamie this time, if you don't mind.
So that is a very, very important lesson to learn, delineating between business and personal. And you know, growing up, I thought, because I was not a Barrett TMS alum. I did go to Bear for the sixth grade, though, right? So, yeah, you know, actually, we were, the three of us were at Baird at the same time in the sixth, that's seventh, right, and eighth grade.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But,
we
were. Yeah. But I did not go to Mail because, you know, I was just doing silly little kid stuff. But I ended up going to Trinity. And for those of you who are not familiar with Louisville, Trinity is a Catholic high school. When I graduated, there were 40 black people in a school of 1,200, yeah, right? And yeah, so I learned in that environment very, very, very early on, not just the cultural differences, but that you cannot, it's not even that you can't open up. There have to be very clear and firm boundaries set. And that served me fantastically well when it comes to the business world, because for me as a financial advisor, you know, my job is not all Wolf of Wall Street, right? And it's not all like Wall Street too, but there are some definite perks that come with the job. I've been privileged enough to go to some pretty amazing places and spend other people's money. all because they want my business, right, you know, and going to places. I personally now counsel all of the other young black advisors that come in and tell them, like, listen, when we go out, you know, I'm from Kentucky. I like bourbon. Mm-hmm. That's my deal, right? Mm-hmm. It's what I like to drink. But you would know that when we go out because I drink red wine.
Right.
And on top of that, there's only a two glass limit. Even if I do have a glass of bourbon, I'm only going to have one, because the thing that really sunk this in, my management partner actually sat down with me, a couple months back, and we were talking, and it was a familiar conversation because I had it with other partners in the firm. And essentially, he was like, listen, I would love to get to know more black people, but right. in the circles that I run in,
yeah.
they're just not there.
Yeah.
You know, you are the only consistent black person that I see day in and day out.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we as black men have always, you know, at Trinity, I learned very, very early on that, you know, when there was a sensitive civil rights issue or a sensitive race issue,
everybody,
you know, the entire class turned around and looked at you, right? Exactly.
That's right.
But even more so, from a business standpoint, you really may be their sole connection to our culture or to this community. And not so much in that, you know, I need to bear the weight of all of the African diaspora on my back for that company. But at the same time, you know, I set those very firm and clear boundaries of like, hey, you know, I'm in Nashville, the Predators are going to the Stanley Cup. Mm-hmm. Hey, Horton, you want to go to the Preds game? Hey, man, listen. No. I did it once when the company was going out, and I did it with a large group to really feel how it would go. And it's like, okay, we'll go to a Preds game. Okay, the game's over at 9 or 10.
Right.
Okay, let's hit Broadway and drink. And it's like, oh, whoa, hey, wait a minute. All of my red flags, all of my warning signs went off.
Yeah.
And so, like any solid married man does, oh, hey, man, look, my wife's going to kill me.
Yeah.
Now, mind you, at this point in time, my wife is obviously asleep. Right. She's not worried about if I'm coming back in the house at whatever time. But,
always a great excuse, though.
It's always a great out. Yeah.
You got to have that
a lot of things.
Yeah, man, because I knew that going down the line, some of the opportunities that I've had, I may not have had I, you know, been in the same situation with you, Teddy, where I had a little too much to drink and I start talking a little too much or start doing X, Y, and Z. And it's like, oh, well, you know, James isn't the person I thought he was.
Right.
You know, so, I had to learn that lesson very early. And, I'm that's what I didn't have to repeat when I got to into the business world of separating the business and personal. Because, you know, it really comes back down to that phrase. It's literally all business. You know, my job is money.
Yeah.
And if you've ever looked on a dollar bill or a $5 bill or 10 or 20, none of the dead presidents are smiling, right? So there should be no emotion in it, right? There's no emotion in money.
Right.
And so I can't have my personal feelings into it, and you shouldn't have your personal feelings into it either, because it's just business.
Right. Right. Look, that is not the first time you gave that speech. I like it. That's good. I like it. Well, you know, it's funny because I went to Trinity as well for my first 2 years before my parents let me go to Eastern. Thank God. And although I love my time at Trinity, shout out to the brothers that I met. Real quick, touching on what you were saying, 40 brothers out of 1,200. One of the best parts of that is when the students came in the morning, there were different lunch tables that everyone sat in.
Well, man.
Let me tell you a rite of passage for any black man that went to Trinity. There was one table that we call Little Africa, right?
Little Africa, man.
Where literally it was only us, or if you got a day pass from someone at the table. Like that was it. That was it, man. So shout out to Trinity for that. So Lawrence, same question, a slightly different field, but I'm sure the same experiences if you think about it. But what are your thoughts on it, sir?
Yeah, you know, my approach to business, you know, listening to Jamie talk and you beforehand in regards to like dealing with coworkers and that type of thing. I've always been an entrepreneur. So I've never really experienced the corporate environment other than my, three internships, engineering internships at a Ford Motor Company. But outside of that, I've always worked in a very free structured environment. And my approach to business has been quite different. Everything is kind of merged for me. There is really no difference between my personal life and my business life, because, you know, what I do with my business is such it's like an extra hand, or it's like an extra arm or something. Mm-hmm. That's just an extension of me in terms of the mission that we have set out with Great Black Speakers and the Black Business School, and, you know, just all the different ventures that, you know, me and my brother have been working on together for the last 10 years. And I definitely understand, you know, where you guys are coming from with that environment. And I'm sure, you know, if I was in that environment, it would be the exact same way. I don't know if I like the party as much as you and Jamie do. from back in the day.
So very fair point.
Yeah. But, you know, if I did, I'd be the exact same way, you know.
I like it, man.
But because, you know, both of you guys know I was always a nerd growing up. And that's probably the thing that I struggle with the most in terms of what you guys are struggling with in terms of separating, like, the business life from, like, your personal life. A lot of times I struggled in the past with, like, bouts of self-confidence in certain ways, mm-hmm. Especially being from Louisville, Kentucky. And, you know, you guys remember me being a nerd back in high school, in middle school and everything. But, you know, I was the worst kind of nerd. I was the nerd who made bad grades, right?
Before you go on this story, all right, now you got to realize that for everyone that's not familiar with Louisville, listening outside of the area, Louisville has, you know, different parts of it, right? So the predominantly black part of Louisville is in the west end of Louisville, and yeah, the west end of Shively, right? But the three of us grew up in the exact opposite side of town, which is the east end, and it's a predominantly white, although there were, you know, there were, I guess, what do you call them? Like, I mean, there were sections of blackness, I guess, right? We had Berrytown.
Yeah,
we had
pockets,
Yeah, pockets, right?
But
I say that because, you know, in the truest form, one of the things that I'm grateful for looking back is, even though we may not have always realized it, we had a community, a very strong community, and that, like, Lawrence, you know, I laugh when you tell this story because I've heard you say this before, but I've never been with you to correct you. But, like, you know, the way I looked at you is the way I looked at Anthony and Keith and Lonnie and you know, I mean, the list goes on. Brian and Brent, like, you were part of the community. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, we were all different. We all
agree.
We all had, you know, good and bad about it, but you didn't make worse grades than I did. So, I mean, like, what? you know what I mean?
Let's
so,
see.
But your story is your story, definitely. I'm just saying that I don't, you know, from the outside looking in, the way I looked at Lawrence wasn't that. But go ahead.
Yeah, and I'm not saying everyone looked at me that way. I guess that's maybe how I looked at myself, too. I think a lot of people did look at me that way. And I'm fine with that because actually that's at the core who I am. I really am a nerd at heart in regards to the things that I like to do.
Yeah.
I think the difference is between, let's say, you and I growing up, Teddy, is, you know, you may have not looked at me that way, but with you, you were so gregarious and had so much of a, like, impact on people's lives in terms of just your presence, you know? I'm sure you heard that before, but just, you know, you being who you are and being able to connect with people on that deep level, and that, from what I've seen, you know, growing up, was one of your best skill sets, being, you know, a leader of men in a way, a leader of people.
Well,
your identity wasn't as.
Let me cut you off
before
you keep on going.
Go ahead.
Don't you do that to me, Lawrence. All right, so.
What you mean?
Don't you do that. But no, I mean, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
But
so I didn't have that. You know, I was, how big was I? I was 5'6" probably at the time, 5'5", 110 pounds.
But
you know what I mean?
But you know what?
Yeah.
But I remember you having fun with us on the bus too in middle school. Like, I don't know.
Go ahead and tell the story you want to go tell about the middle school, about the bus.
Which one?
When you had to come true.
No, I'm not gonna.
You're gonna tell it. I'm gonna tell it.
All right. No, I wouldn't even say. Okay. All right. I literally had to think about that. So, what was it? You know what? Yeah, you know what? This is only proving my point, though. I will say this, then we'll get back to it.
Okay. All right.
So this is what I remember. Correct me if I'm wrong. We were on the bus, right? And Lawrence lived in the neighborhood that was right by ours. So the way that it worked, it was I remember the lineup. Actually, now that I think about it, I have not thought about this in years. How funny is that? All right, so it was me, Patrick Crudup, Nick Starr, Todd Mitchell, and I think they let Coldstream off because they were coming back to Fincastle. So, yeah. So, you know, Keith wasn't on there. So, anyway, so for some reason, there were these kids, whenever Lawrence got off the bus, there were these kids, they were white, right?
One was white, one was black.
Okay, all right. There were these kids that, like, when Lawrence got off the bus, they were just messing with them. Like, you know, we didn't know if they were from a different school, what the history was, whatever. So we had a pretty cool bus driver, Mr. Kelly. and we were appealing to Mr. Kelly, just like, hey, Mr. Kelly, listen, you don't have to do anything, but when Lawrence gets out, just, you know, keep the door open for a little bit and let us back in. And to his credit, he was with it, because I guess he saw what we saw the other day when Lawrence got off. They were messing with him. I was like, nah, not the homie. So sure enough, Lawrence gets off the bus. These kids come up thinking they're big and bad. And we're ducking in the front seat. Mr. Kelly keeps the door open, and man, we come out like X-Men, right? So,
yeah,
I think I was the first one to connect, and then Patrick. You know, I mean, I'm not going to go into details, but I'm saying like we enacted our revenge is the point, because you were part of the village. Like, that's part of the point I was making, man. Like, you know, I mean, we might throw jokes on each other, but you don't mess with our dude. Like, get out of here,
right?
Man. So. Yeah, that's funny. How you got me telling that story on a podcast. That's funny.
You know what? It's a fond memory of mine, too, because I appreciate that. And yeah, I think that proves that shows that we're both right in terms of what we're saying.
Yeah.
In our background. You know, I was a part of the community, you know, that you were really a leader of, and I ain't trying to put you out there, but you were, right? So I was a part of the community, but then it also shows that I was still kind of a nerd who couldn't really fight back then, you know, at the same time. So, yeah. You know, just thinking about both of those different types of things, yeah. You know, in the early days, it really had me struggling with my self-confidence and like, what's my place in the world? Am I good enough to do what I want to accomplish in life? Will people buy into what I have to sell? Like those different types of questions just happened in high school, happened a little bit in college. Things started to change a little bit more. You know, when I joined Alpha, also when I ran for student government president. Nice. So a lot of those issues started to go away. But still, deep down inside of me, they were always there. That inkling of self-doubt. Am I good enough to really be doing what I'm doing? And I just think about that in terms of, you know, where you guys may struggle with separating your business from your personal life. Mine is pretty merged, but the thing that I struggle with back then and still struggle with now is, am I really good enough to accomplish what I'm setting out to accomplish? And, you know, I deal with that and cope with that not by not really thinking about it and just saying, well, if I'm good enough, I'm good enough. I'm not, and let the cards fall where they may. But it's that belief and confidence in yourself that is such a driving force as an entrepreneur.
Right.
So when you're able to believe in yourself and believe in the product, and as an entrepreneur, you are at the core, the product of what you're selling. You know, that belief is something that I've always struggled with, and it's helped me sometimes. It's hurt me a lot more times. But you know, that's kind of, you know, the thing that has shaped me over my life is just struggling with, you know, making sure that I believe. And I think everyone who is out there listening to this, that when you're selling anything, that's the first thing that you need to do. It's believe in yourself and believe in the product that you're actually selling. So if you can accomplish that, all the other stuff comes a lot easier.
Man, love that. Love that, man. And
so true.
Yeah. It's you're going to give me the preaching, because that's one of the benefits of doing this show is hearing confirmations like that, you know. And self-confidence is so important, not only in your professional life, whatever you choose to do for a living, but just in everyday interactions with people, man. And that is awesome. Because to me, I love that someone's going to hear this and look at three successful men and hear that all three of us, you know, doing well in life, checking all the boxes that you want to check if you're looking at respectability politics, right? But but we still have confidence issues. We still, you know, struggle with that from time to time, and that's okay, because you don't dwell in it. You don't stay there. You use it as motivation and you push forward and you continue to grow, man. So beautiful word, man. Beautiful word. All right. So what we're gonna do, family, we got off to a strong start. Strong start coming out the gate. Hitting y'all with knowledge. All right, so we're gonna take a quick break. Stay with us, and we will continue this conversation with James Horton. Oh, sorry, Jamie Horton and Lawerence Watkins. All right, y'all.
Oh, you were made for greatness, baby. You were made for greatness, and don't you let them tell you nothing else. You were made for greatness. Oh, you were made for greatness, baby. And don't you let them tell you, I know how it is to take a loss. They ain't seeing your passion, and every year they write you off. I can tell you that's taxing. Kill your dreams and they haunt you. They make it very hard to sleep. But the benefit of that is I'm awake now. I can't tell you how many times I thought to call it quits. I'm only here cause God been on my side through all of this. I'm only here cause I'm G'ing all my doubts in this. My friends and family hold me up, won't let me fall in this. Please believe from the inception of my purpose, it's been bigger than me. Christopher Nolan came direct our dreams. Don't understand why anybody would wanna stop us. We just trying to bring flavor to the table like a potluck. I'm rambling, and before you get to hating, before my verse end, I'll sum it up like calculators. You are here for more. There's a purpose on the trail you blazing. It's amazing. Reflect God, reflect greatness. You were made for greatness.
Thanks for sticking with us, and we are back with our, I mean, I can call y'all, like, you know, the professional panel. Isn't that cool? That's a cool sounding name. Yeah.
I like the homies better.
Yeah, the homies. Nice. The homies.
Yeah.
Lawerence and Jamie, man. So real quick before we get back into it, hey, I know I told y'all before, it's just good to talk to y'all. Like, it's been a while. Mm-hmm. I'm glad that we can get caught up.
It's been a long time.
And this is a reminder to everybody listening, don't make it so long. Like, why?
Yeah,
why, man?
Man?
Life.
Please, don't make it long.
You know, what do you do? What do you do? Right? So, but that being said, we kind of discussed the first part of what we wanted to. So we have an opportunity to do a lot of things in life. Whoever you are and whatever way that you look at life in general, you have what's considered a blank slate for the future in a lot of ways. And one of the ways that people plan for, of course, is, you know, I mean, who they choose to be with and marry, relationships. It's all well and good. Where they live, which, by the way, where are we calling you from, Lawerence?
I am in Las Palmas in the Canary Islands off the coast of Africa. Off the coast of Morocco.
I feel like you just started like the next Big Timers album. Like
yo, baby, where we at, baby? Where you at?
Whoa, Kimosabi. Nah, so that's one of the great luxuries that this life has afforded you, is that you can really run your business from anywhere in the world, and you do, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's awesome. Like, I will mention it just because it ties into one of the shows that I love. Like, let me tell you about Lawerence Online, right? So, like, literally, Lawerence has some great posts, and the other day he just threw out there, it's just like, hey, listen, I mean, anybody gonna be in Medellin? What'd you say it was? I was like, yo, you going to Pablo Escobar's hometown, bro? Like,
he was, man. He was.
That's our new home, man. So Medellin, Colombia. That's probably gonna be our home base. So we have a home base in Louisville or Columbus, Ohio, where Carlos, my wife's family, lives there right now. But Medellin is, I think it's a place that I consider home now. Louisville's definitely home, but in terms of where we're going to be spending a lot of time, it'll definitely be in Medellin, Colombia.
Nice.
And Medellin.
You know what? I apologize. I didn't give you brothers an opportunity to say hello to the family if you want to take a second. I mean, you just referenced your lovely wife. I mean, anybody else you want
to? That's right. Yeah, she's right here. She's in another room.
All right.
Shout out to.
Well, can she hear me? Just out of curiosity.
No, she can't hear you.
Okay, so just start saying like a whole bunch of great stuff real quick. Just go ahead.
She's amazing. she's absolutely wonderful, man. I'm the luckiest man in the world to have Carla as my wife.
Nice, you are
my yeah. So
you're welcome, sir. All right, Jamie, you want to take time to mention anybody in that family of yours, sir?
You know, here's the thing. Let me just start by saying I was sitting here thinking about how long I've known each of you, right? You talking about family.
Right.
I remember when you broke your zipper for the 88 church directory picture. Do you remember this, Teddy? And you had to hold the banner in front of you, right? So shout out to Green Castle, okay? Shout out to my mom, my brother, all of my family in Louisville. You know, shout out to my wife. Right. Shout out to my daughter. You know, if you know me well enough to call me Jamie, then I love you too.
I appreciate that's right. It. Yeah, shout out. And you know what? All three of us, I didn't realize all three of us, we do. I didn't think about it, have older siblings. So
Shout out to Soaring Eagles track team.
Shout out to Soaring Eagles.
Can we just take a second to talk about Soaring Eagles? Like, do y'all remember me on that team?
Okay, I don't.
There's a reason.
There's a reason, right? So I went out there one day, and I was like, "Y'all look crazy, man! Like, yeah, y'all literally just stand around running all the time. I can't,
man. You know, Soaring Eagles started literally in my living room. I'll never forget, man. Yeah, we were all running for Westside. Shout out to Chico Underwood. Mm-hmm. I mean, mm-hmm. just a legend, right? But we decided that, you know, there needed to be a black track club in the East End, and legit, it started in my living room. And I mean, they had a heck of a run, man. A heck of a run.
Yeah.
Shout out to the Raspberry family.
I was about to say the
Raspberries.
Yeah, on, man. Like, absolutely.
The Ogdiabo family.
I was about to say there's two
Simi,
families.
Timmy and Boo.
Right. The Raspberries. We stood on the shoulders of greatness. Shout out to y'all, man. Shout out to y'all. But all right, so one of the ways that we do plan, now that we mentioned our family, they won't kill us. So one of the ways that we do plan is not just with family and career, but financially, okay? And one of the easy ways that people always talk about, you know, what your goal is in retirement, and when you get older, here's what you want to do. Jamie, you and I mentioned that we work for bigger corporations. So, of course, we know a lot of people out there listening are familiar with the 401ks, right? The thing that's taking X percent out of your check every month. And it's just like, man, I don't know if this is enough. I don't know if I should be doing more. but, you know, there's one thing that I've learned is not just with you know, 401ks, but in general with finances, is there is a completely different world that's operating that unless you really seek it out and you're once again intentional about trying to get as much information as you can, that you have no idea what's going on. So for me, it was you know, starting to get into the stock market a little bit and realizing, you know, certain terms, what are yields, what are bonds, what am I looking at with you know, with even with the college saving plans, the 529s, like, you know, all these wonderful products. So if you were talking to someone and they came to you as just like, Jamie, I know you know your stuff, right? What is it that I need to know that I may not know right now? And how would you suggest that I learn about that?
Well, I mean, yeah, what the situation that you just described is like my everyday work life from about 9 a.m. to about 4 p.m. on a daily basis. So I guess to give you a little bit of insight on my practice, my practice works with medical professionals and families, right? Those are, if I had a niche market, those would be my niches, right? Mm-hmm. And so in starting working with the medical professionals, dentists, physicians, and pharmacists primarily, what I found early on is that, you know, in talking to a lot of seasoned pharmacists or seasoned dentists and seasoned physicians, answering the same questions that you just asked, they got to the end of the conversation and they said the same thing every time. I wish I met you 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And so going back to catch them while they're still students and residents before they make all the financial mistakes is really, you know, that's like the most rewarding part. But the most important thing, maybe the two most important things that I don't think people truly realize, and, you know, we live in such a magnificent time. You know, my daughter is 12 now, and all the questions that we used to have to go and try and get a dictionary encyclopedia out and flip through this 1,000-page book.
Yeah.
Right? Right? Yeah. And my daughter can go pick up her iPad, type it in, and boom, it's right there. You know, so, and the other thing is that, you know, we also live in a world now where what I do 50 years ago, I probably wouldn't have been able to do, A, but B, was relegated for a certain tax bracket. Mm. And now, you know, there are certain base things that we feel everybody should have access to, right? So the very first thing is that compound interest is your best friend.
It's the ninth wonder of the world. It's the
or
ninth,
worst
it
enemy.
Is the ninth wonder of the world.
Yeah, you know what? That's a good point. Or worst enemy, right? When it comes
very
to
true.
Death, yeah.
Very true. Very true. But yeah, I mean, Einstein was 100% right about it being the ninth wonder of the world.
Yeah.
And the key for everything is just simply starting early. There are so many things that I wish I would have done with the money I made in high school. Mm-hmm. You know, just thinking about... I'll tell you guys a funny story with this. In the seventh grade, I won the stock market game, right? And I told my father then, I was like, "Dad, listen, I know you think I just pulled this out of nowhere, but I've really been studying this stuff. I've been reading the paper, okay? Because that was our source of information, right?
That's right?
Dad, I've been reading the paper. I've been watching this stock every single day, all right? I think, Dad, you should take some money and invest in this particular stock. It won me the stock market game."
Right.
That particular stock was only like $4 a share back then, right?
Okay.
That stock was Dell Computer.
Oh.
Right?
Oh.
Right?
And this was now, this was like 90.
Yeah, this is like 95, 96.
Yeah, yeah, something like that. Yeah.
Right? So this is early. And so.
That was even before the Dude You Got a Dell commercials. How about that?
Exactly. It's way before that.
Yeah.
And so. You fast forward in college, and my senior year, I'm working at Dell. You know, I was doing IT support, you know, in between semesters in the summer. And, you know, I'm looking, and I can see that Dell's share price is now $44 a share. And please understand that I called my father and was like, "Listen, Dad, we could have made so much money." All right?
Yeah.
But that was number one. The second one hurts the absolute worst, okay? Yeah. And this goes back to compound interest, and it's still on topic. My junior year, I took an investments class, and I built with a fake $1 million. I built a hypothetical portfolio, okay? And so I picked out some of the stocks that I thought were the best and would make me the most money. I had Brown-Forman, A-Shares. I had Exxon. I had Apple.
Oh.
And I had Johnson & Johnson. Those are my stocks. And I had, you know, some bond positions as well.
Right.
But at that point in time, Apple had just come out with the iPod. Okay. They had the big multicolored Macs. You guys remember those with the fat backs,
that's
right?
That's what I remembered first from this generation of Apple, like going to Zachary Taylor and seeing those multicolored Macs. Yeah.
Yep. But Apple back then was like $50 a share. And over the course of my 6-week project, it went up to $55, all right? And, you know, of course, as you guys may or may not know, the stock market is incredibly volatile. And so it went up to 61 at one point, but came down and settled at 55. Mm-hmm. And I was happy with that. And so I called home, Dad, listen, I need $10,000.
Oh, okay. That's where it goes. Huh? Okay.
Yeah. And so my dad was like, oh, 10,000, huh? Okay. What for? And I'm like, Dad, listen, there's a brand. This company is not new, but they've had a resurgence. They've had a restructuring. Right. It's Apple, okay? And they have this thing called an iPod. Right. Dad, it's like having all of the tapes that you would put inside, you know, the car. You can have it all in one place at one time. All of those songs at once. It is amazing. Right. And Dad, listen, I heard in the next couple of years, they're going to come out with a phone. And I'm like, you know, I'm giving him all the, you know, price to earnings ratio. We're getting into all the financials about it. He's like, okay, all right. He let me get through all that. I was like, now, honestly, Dad, I need $10,000.
Yeah,
that's all I need. Now, of course, in my 19-year-old mind, my father was an endless repository of money,
right,
and $10,000, right. He could just make it happen, right? Because you know, I had never paid a bill at that point. I'm 19. I'm in college. You know what I mean? Like I'm a year away from high school.
Right.
You know what I mean? So my sense of money is incredibly warped. Right? Mm-hmm. But needless to say, my father's response was, "Well, if you want $10,000 and you believe in this so strongly, go to the bank, get a $10,000 loan, and invest in that yourself."
Yes.
Now,
and you did. For those that's of you that why you're calling me from the helicopter right now.
You're right. That's why I'm calling you from my private island in the Canary Islands as well.
That's right. Next door neighbor to Lawrence. That's what's up.
But yeah, man, that just starting early. It doesn't have to be something like that. Like, you know, you don't have to have XYZ with an investment. Just start something early.
Yeah.
Whatever it is. Start saving early. Start investing early. Start doing something early. The number two thing is probably what we see is the most glaring gap in most people's overall financial strategy, and that's protection, right? Because you know, you go to school, you work, you know, the lots and lots of insurance agents out here who, you know, no shade to insurance agents. You know, insurance is a fantastic thing. But when you think insurance, most people think life insurance.
Right.
And think that, oh, this is the most important thing. But if you are injured or can't go back to work, life insurance, most forms of life insurance, will not give you a salary replacement to continue doing what it is that you're doing. And so making sure that you have all of your ducks in a row, whether that's having a disability policy, not just through work, but understanding what that is, how it works for you. If you have the privilege of being an entrepreneur like myself or Lawrence, and you can't go back into work, okay, well, if you're the product, how can you keep the proverbial lights on in your company? If you have staff, how are you going to pay your staff if you can't go to work to generate income? And having something in place to protect all of those things, we call it, you know, you go to work, you go to school to make money to drive the vehicle of your life, right? Money is the gas that goes in that tank. And if you can't physically get out and pump that gas, you have to. It is your responsibility as a husband if you're married, but more so as a man, as someone who is trying to protect their dream, to make sure that the vehicle that you're in can take you to where you need to go. And you can't have that if you don't have that part protected. And so for me, from a base standpoint, it's saving. And most people who say, oh my God, I don't, you know, I pay my bills and I got $1,000 and then I look up the day before payday and I've got 73 cents in my account. Yeah. I don't know where my money goes.
Yeah.
Chances are pretty high. You're eating your money. Cause that's one thing you don't think about.
Oh man.
But,
talk about it.
You know,
jeez.
Yeah, man, you know, cash flow management is something that I delve into very deeply because it's something I think, again, everybody struggles with. Not everybody can relate to paying $15,000 in taxes or, you know, like, hey, I need to bring in another $1 million from this offshore account. Not everybody can relate to that, but everybody can relate to, hey, I think I spent more money on this food than I should have. It was really good, but I'm a little tight. Everybody can relate to that. And so from a just a general general standpoint, compound interest, saving or investing, either or, and protecting your income. And how you found out about that, I mean, if you guys like the sound of my voice and think that I'm funny, and you know, feel free to check in with me. I'm sure we'll provide some information in the show.
Absolutely.
Or if you don't, that's fine, because that, you know, I'm not here for that.
We'll put your information in the show notes as well as Lawrence's. So if you visit both websites and or contact them, let them know you came from Why Not. All right, there you go.
Yeah, that'd be great.
There you go. But yeah, so that's such sage advice, because I was not necessarily a military person, right? But I was in ROTC because I just had too many electives. Transferred from Trinity to Eastern, I was like, "What? What do I do with these religions classes?" Right? So I had a chance to take ROTC my senior year, and shout out to Colonel, I can't remember his last name, but he suggested that we do exactly what you said, and that is invest early, invest often, and compound interest. And he was literally the person that was driving home the points that my dad always made to me when it came to finance, because one of the benefits of, you know, having a dad that was into that is, you know, I grew up reading the Fortune magazines, the Business Week, but my favorite was like the Black Enterprise, you know, and like you saw, one, just, you know, the people that we were around in general, we saw successful people, but in these magazines, you saw, you know, these extremely successful people, and you got to hear their stories and their strategies. And really, it's not much different than what you're saying now. You know, when you see an opportunity, take it. Don't be afraid of some risk. And going back to what we're talking about before, Lawrence, was the self-confidence, you know, and finance can really be handled in a lot of different ways. And one of the things I wanted to talk about is, I think your business concept is incredible. I really do, man. And if you don't mind, just take a second and go into a little bit more detail about, you know, if not the business plan, just the business in general, because I really think it's something that people will be into.
All right, you're talking to me or Jamie with that?
I was talking to Lawrence, but I can talk to Jamie if you want. I mean,
oh, okay, no, that's not good. Yeah. we're both entrepreneurs, got us making dollars over here.
Yeah,
so, I didn't know. Well, actually, I'm a part of a few different companies, right?
Yep.
So,
yep.
My original company was Great Black Speakers.
And for the record, and, don't be humble. Just go in. Tell them about it, Lawrence.
Yeah, just tell them about it. Yeah, so we help organizations find African-American public speakers for their events. So we're a platform that connects speakers with organizations. We bring the two sides together and get paid a commission off the sale. Mm-hmm. We recently relaunched our auxiliary platform, or I guess our sister product called Great Pro Speakers. And if Great Black Speakers is our marketing and distribution side of our ecosystem, then Great Pro Speakers is our training and development site. So it's a site that we put together to teach professionals, entrepreneurs, academics, how to transform their expertise into additional income via paid speaking and information marketing. So it's kind of like your step-by-step course to help guide you through creating a strong speaking business. Not necessarily the art of becoming a better speaker, but the business aspect of it, to where you're not just giving your time pro bono for speeches, and how do you start getting paid for sharing your knowledge and expertise.
So the perfect, like if someone wanted to improve as a speaker, first they would go to Toastmasters, and then after that, that's when they would go to, they can do both,
yeah.
Great Pro Speakers and Toastmasters. So Toastmasters for the actual speech, and then you for the business portion of it, right?
Yeah, exactly. So we do a little bit of the art of professional speaking too. But in terms of split, it's probably 80% business and 20% in terms of how to become a better speaker. But the platform is definitely focused on the business aspect of professional speaking, because that's where a lot of speakers get caught up. You know, they grew up in the church, or, you know, they have a finance practice, or or they just, you know, spent all this time getting their PhD in school. And they have this knowledge and they have this ability to motivate and inspire others. They just don't have an audience. So our job is to teach them how to gain an audience. And in addition to that, we teach them how to keep that audience once the audience comes. And how do you protect and continue to grow your money through your information sharing? So that's the concept of great pro speakers. And it's a site that I'm really excited about working with Al Duncan. So he was one of my first speakers, actually. I started Great Black Speakers 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. So we started in January 2007 as an extension of the work that I was doing with my brother, Dr. Boyce Watkins, when I was helping him manage and grow his speaking career when he was a professor at Syracuse University. So one thing led to another, and, you know, Great Pro Speakers and Great Black Speakers came into existence. And one of my first speakers in Great Black Speakers was Al. And he acted, you know, somewhat as like a client, but halfway as a mentor to me as well. Nice. Within the speaking industry. You know, teach me a lot about, you know, some of the ins and outs, the tactical things, in regards to getting engagements and getting gigs for other people. And from there, you know, about 5 years after we started Great Black Speakers, I came back to him and pitched this concept of creating this platform, this educational platform for those interested in getting paid for speaking engagements. And that's how Great Pro Speakers came about. We're really excited. So those are just two of the companies that I work with. I'm also president and chief operating officer of Boyce Watkins Enterprises. So, you know, the different, I guess, conglomerate companies that we've worked on, most notably the Black Business School. And that's something that I'm really excited about, considering that I went to business school at Cornell and also engineering school. I'm excited about the Black Business School because we're creating a high quality, low cost education for those who want to learn how to start their own business or learn how to invest their money. And the most exciting thing is how it's so different than what I was actually taught in business school. Really? In terms of, you know, so the thing about B school, especially B school, like, you know, like an Ivy or, you know, one of the great, quote unquote, great institutions of business education, they teach you a lot of theoretical knowledge, but most of it's not really practical to the day-to-day running of your company. And I knew this going in, and the reason I went to business school wasn't necessarily for the education. For me, it was more the brand association and networks that come with being like an alum of the school. Education was the third reason why I went to B school, but that was definitely behind the brand and also behind, so it's also definitely behind the brand and also behind, you know, just having that network after you graduate. That doesn't work well for most people nowadays. It's definitely a luxury. So I was on a scholarship. So the only thing I had to worry about was the opportunity cost. So, you know, what was I giving up by attending B school? You know, I was running my company for 2 years, but I thought it would be worth it. But most people in our community, they don't have that luxury to just learn theoretical knowledge because it's not going to help them in their day-to-day lives immediately. Right. So we created the Black Business School as a way for people who want to better their lives, better the lives of their family, start creating generational wealth, to have an opportunity to have access to that information, to have access to that knowledge that is often, you know, walled off in the, you know, secret garden of rich people, to be quite honest with you. So what we did was, you know, we started the platform. We got people like Jamie. Jamie's not, you know, one of our instructors, but individuals like him and others who have very practical knowledge in regards to how do you build wealth? How do you start a business? How do you start a franchise? How do you invest in the stock market? And we started having them to teach classes to people who are within our community. So far, so good. We have over 30,000 students on the Black Business School.
This is why I told you to stop being humble, Lawrence.
Yeah. did I bury the lead?
you just nonchalantly throw out that you're going to Pablo Escobar's hometown. and you have 30,000 students. I'm just saying.
No. He's not going to Pablo Escobar's hometown.
I'm sorry.
That is his home base. His home base is in Medellin.
You know what? Let us stump for you. Let us be Baby and Mandy Fresh over here for you. Man,
right. Okay. Man. There we go. Yeah. Well, go ahead, get a little ditty in there, bad boy.
That's right.
So, you know, we're managing that. It's a full-time job within itself, but managing that, great Black speakers and great pro speakers simultaneously definitely keeps me busy, but it's a part of my mission in life in regards to why I'm here, you know, what's my purpose. And what I usually bring to the table when starting any company is the ability to create systems that others can benefit from. So, you know, I'm not the most gregarious person or vocal person or anything like that, but when it comes to creating systems that can be used by others and deployed by others, that's my area of core expertise. I know that, and that's where I invest, you know, all of my time in terms of making that better instead of trying to mask my faults or my weaknesses.
That's beautiful, man. That's beautiful. That's, yeah. I mean, listen, I knew you were doing most of that, but some of it, I learned something. How about that?
Yeah,
me too. Me too, man.
That's incredible. Thank you, so, listen, part of being semi-professional, I say semi because, you know, there's no guarantee for me day to day, is I gotta respect your time, right? I told you, gentlemen, what the goal was that we were shooting for, and we're right at it. So, unfortunately, because I can stay here for another couple of hours, but I mean, I think, Lawrence, where you are, it might be midnight for all we know. Who knows?
It is actually. It's 11:50 p.m.
Let me wrap it up. But real quick, before you guys do give your information, I'm just proud of y'all. I really am proud of y'all. You are doing incredible things, and I appreciate you taking some time to talk to the people and just reconnect with me, man. And let's not make it another, 6 years, 7 years, something crazy like that, you know?
All right. Well, one conversation is 6 or 7 years. So probably one conversation about 10 or 11, 12.
That's right. Yeah. Valid. That's very valid, man. So Lawrence, if you don't mind, just recap again where they can reach you and if they're interested and how they would go about that.
Yeah. So if you're interested in great pro speakers, so you want, or you have interest in becoming a professional speaker, you've done a few engagements, but they might have been pro bono or something like that, you can reach out to us at www.greatprospeakers.com. That's greatprospeakers.com. My email address is lawrence@greatprospeakers.com. If you want to subscribe to one of our courses in the Black Business School, you can head over to www.theblackbusinessschool.com. That's theblackbusinessschool.com. Most of our courses have a free, or I guess a 30-day free trial if you want to try it out. And if you don't like it, you can cancel risk-free. But we hope that we keep you on board. So there we go.
Awesome. And Mr. Jamie Horton.
Yeah, so for anybody who wants more information, you can reach me via email, JamesHorton@financialguide.com. You can call my office, 615-309-6372. You can find me on LinkedIn. If you really want to hop on the internet, you can go to advisors.massmutual.com /James-Horton or CapitalFinancialGroup.net, or, you know, call Teddy and he'll put you directly in contact with
after,
me.
After I bet you. Like, you know.
Of course.
All right. Awesome. Once again, this has been a great episode because of these gentlemen. So thank you again for joining us. And as always, family, stay tuned. We have some great shows coming up. A preview. And if you look in your feed, you'll notice that we have more than likely another Baylor's Thought coming, but we also have a show that I'm really excited about. So I'll give those brothers a shout out. I told them I would. We are going to be recording one of our meetings of the minds that I've alluded to on the shows before. This is a group of roughly 8 to 10 brothers here in Louisville We get together. So I've reserved a restaurant. I'm bringing the equipment. I'm trying to make sure everybody's got headphones. And we will give you a preview of what one of these meetings is like without all the cussing. You know, we're going to try to keep it clean somehow. So as always, thank you for joining me. And 5-star reviews. And you can also find me on the Black Astronauts podcast. Right now, if you go to Patreon and or PayPal and show some love, there are benefits. You will get premium shows. And, of course, you can hang out with us on Fire Chat. So, all right, thank you again, and we will see y'all next time. Peace.
I know of a place not too far away that maybe you and I could both go someday. But I gotta make sure, cause I ain't trying to stay here. What? Don't y'all realize that the end is so near? What? But don't you have fear, cause you still got time. I hope you wanna come when I'm done with the rhyme. Let me explain so you won't pretend you didn't know. No. And you can make sure that this is where you wanna go. It's all about preparing.